words of hope, proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ in the languages of the world's peoples.
Create in me a clean heart, because my heart is rotten through and through. But then he also continues to say, renew a right spirit within me. A spirit that goes with a new heart is a spirit that will keep the word of God, walk in the presence of God, walk through the power of the Lord, and as everything else would move and move very well. I believe very strongly that unless God does a miracle in a person's life, unless God changes somebody's heart, the attitude of a sinner will always be rebellious against God. But when God gives a new heart to a believer, the believer begins to receive a new spirit and therefore a new attitude of obedience to God. David is crying for it. You know how I pray that we in this country, we in the district of Nebi and Zombo, we the people of God will seek God to give them new hearts, so that our attitudes are different. Our ways of looking at things are different. Our way of treating people are different. We are totally different people. Only God can do that. Look at verse 11, and I want to read 11, 12 to 13. David said, cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Do not pass me by. Do not pass me by. Do not cast me away from your presence, because in your presence is security, joy, peace, and safety. Once you cast me out there, Lord, out there are lions and leopards and people who can destroy me within no moment. The kingdom of darkness, the demonic forces, if you take me away from you, I am a finished person. So do not cast me away from your presence. And then he said, do not take away your Holy Spirit from me, because he's the one who brings the awareness of God in my life. He's the one who makes me walk in that fear of God. The Holy Spirit shows me the way to God. He's the one who gives me the power that enables me to do what pleases you. When you take the Holy Spirit from me, I am powerless. I am useless. I will lose my sense of direction. I will never know what I'm supposed to do. Your Holy Spirit, don't take him away from me. And then he continues to say, restore to me the joy of your salvation in verse 12. Meaning, when I walked in sin, I lost my joy. And isn't it true today? That when you commit sin, you lose the joy of the Lord. You become guilty. You begin to fear people. But I'm asking you to restore the joy of your salvation, which I received when I met you, when I came to know you as my God. Restore that joy back to me. And then I will do something. I will proclaim your name in verse 13. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. I will proclaim your name. I will give testimonies. I will be able to speak out about you, my God, who is full of mercy and is able to forgive, is able to forget, my God and my Lord. My point number 8. He says, deliver me from the sin of murder. Look at verse 14. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God. O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. He remembered that he ordered the death of Uriah. And Joab, his commander, orchestrated it very cleverly without Uriah knowing. He was swarmed, he was surrounded, he was killed, and the guilt went back to him. He knew he was the one who killed Uriah, and that guilt was weighing upon his life. The conviction in his heart was heavy because he knew he committed sin, the sin of murder. And the law says, do not commit murder. Now he's pleading with God. He said, God, take away this heaviness within me. Let me speak to you. Have you murdered anybody? Perhaps accidentally or maybe not. Maybe you planned to kill and you did kill. There is still hope in you. There is still hope for you in God, who David is crying to get away that guilt out of him. Run to God the way David did. Plead with God the way David is pleading. Cry your way to the Lord the way David is doing. He said, help me, deliver me. I know I'm a murderer. I know I'm a killer. And this God, you remember Nathan said, you are not going to die. You are not going to die. God has mercy on you. But that child will never live, because that child was an insult. That child was an insult to the God whom you have known all your life when you were a little boy. And then he says, I want you, Lord God, to help me, because when you take away my guilt, in verse 15, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise. When guilt is gone, then you can have a cause to praise the Lord, because your heart is free to rejoice and to bless God and to honor his holy name. Remove the guilt away, Lord, and open my mouth, then I will declare your praise. An amazing plea to God. Then the final one, verse 9. He said, I will give you the right sacrifice. I will give you the right sacrifice. Let me read verse 16 and 17. For you will not delight in the sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Listen to me, beloved. God doesn't need your money. God doesn't need your bull, your cow. God doesn't need your goat. God doesn't need your house. God does not need your car. He doesn't need those things. The reason is simple. There is nothing that you have not received from God. Whatever you want to give him is a gift to you. You just got it because he gave them to you. All that we have, all that we are, come from God. If God needed a bull, my friend, he could get a buffalo from the wild, and if he wanted anything bigger, it would be an elephant, not your bull. God can get a better sacrifice for himself. That's not what he needs. You remember when Saul was sent by God to go and destroy the Amalekites and destroy everything, but he could not. He took the animals, he took their king, Agag, and he brought them home because he wanted to make a sacrifice to the Lord. Samuel was disappointed. He said, obedience is better than sacrifice. It's important you obey God rather than trying to give him something. Now, what is the right sacrifice? This is verse 17. The sacrifice of God are a broken spirit. A broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. It is coming broken before God in repentance, asking God for forgiveness, turning your back to the sin that has displeased God, coming before him in tears and saying, Lord, have mercy on my life. And that is why, as I conclude, I want to ask you to confess to God so that you can have life and not death. I ask you in the name of Jesus to confess to God so that your heart can rest. If you're not resting because of guilt, if you're in trouble because of guilt, ask the Lord in repentance, ask the Lord for forgiveness, and peace will come in your heart. Confess to God and receive the mercy of God even tonight as you listen to me. I pray that his mighty Holy Spirit will convict you enough like he did David, and you will turn to God and weep before God and ask him to let you be free, and free indeed. Let me pray for you. Lord God and Holy God, I want to thank you the way our eyes are opening because of David and his confession. This psalm is so deep. This psalm is full of pain. This psalm is also full of repentance. Lord, we want to be like David, to ask you for forgiveness. Lord, where we have gone wrong, will you forgive us? Where we have done things that do not please you, Father, will you forgive us? where we have hurt other people and you, God, are not happy the way he did Uriah and Bathsheba. Will you forgive us?
Brought to you by Words of Hope, Bishop Henry Luke Orombi, a retired Archbishop of the Church of Uganda.